Exact continuous symmetry is gauged in string theory, and also if we consider some global symmetries in the bulk of ADS-CFT, then there is some difficulty. But today's talk is most related to this Euclidean wormhole argument for Coleman and Giddings-Strominger. So first, let me very briefly review this argument. So suppose that we have two universes, universe A and universe B. And this universe B may be some baby universes. But anyway, so suppose that there are two universes. Then wormholes can connect these two universes. And through this wormhole, global charge can flow from universe A to universe B. And then if that happens, then from the point of view of universe A, the global charge seems to disappear. So in that way, the global charge is not conserved, at least from the point of view of this universe A. So that was the basic argument. However, this Euclidean wormholes also pose some difficult conceptual questions. So Euclidean wormholes can connect two points on spacetime, x and y, and they can be very far from each other in spacetime. Then if we consider gravitational configuration, including this Euclidean wormhole, then this wormhole may produce a non-local interaction like this in the low energy effective action. So this is non-local, so this is difficult to interpret. And one possible interpretation of this non-local coupling is proposed by Coleman, and this is an interpretation in terms of random coupling. So in this interpretation, we rewrite this non-local interaction in this way. So in this term, basically we have just a local term. So this is some operator O integrated over single coordinate X. So this looks like just a local interaction. So it is okay, but it is now multiplied by this alpha. And this alpha can be regarded as a coupling constant, which is multiplying this operator interaction. And then the integration over this parameter alpha is interpreted as a random coupling. So in this way, we may interpret this non-local interaction in terms of local interaction with random coupling. And I think people are not so sure whether this interpretation is really correct or not. But recently, a similar phenomenon was shown in an exact resolvable two-dimensional model, which is called JT gravity. So maybe we have to think about this possibility more seriously. And so in this description, this operator breaks the global symmetry. But in this argument, it is not clear whether the random coupling is really essential for global symmetry violation. So it is better if there's some situation or some another gravitational configuration in which we can see the violation more clearly, without the issue of random coupling or non-local interactions. And that is a topic of this talk. So the main claims of this talk are the following. First, I argue that global symmetries can be violated by topologies in the Euclidean path integrals. So this is the first main message. And also, In the case of higher form symmetries, which are compactified to zero form symmetries, we can see this violation without using the non-local terms or random couplings. So I will talk about the details of these points. But before going to the details, let me make a remark. So what I will discuss is some gravitational configuration which produce a local term like this without alpha parameter. And this local operator breaks the global symmetry. Then, so this is very conceptually clear. So in the low energy effective action, we just have local term without random, without this alpha parameter, and this breaks the global symmetry. So and this is produced by some gravitational configuration. So this is a very clear demonstration of violation of global symmetries in quantum gravity. But there are still some gravitational configurations like Euclidean wormholes, which do lead to non-local terms. And I will not try to discuss interpretations of these gravitational configurations, which produce this type of non-local terms. I just talk about gravitational configurations, which produce this one. Okay, so first, I'd like to discuss the general mechanism of global symmetry violation by topology. So global symmetries can be violated by topology, and there are also related work by these authors in the context of replica wormholes. The point is that local current conservation does not imply global charge conservation due to some complicated topologies in Euclidean path integrals. So let me discuss this point. And in this talk, I will always talk about p-form symmetry. So this this concept of p-form symmetry is just a very natural generalization of ordinary symmetry. And ordinary symmetry is a case of p equal zero. So this p-form symmetry is described by p plus one form current. So ordinary symmetry can be described by one form current, and this p form symmetry is described by p plus one form. And then we can take the Hodge star of this current. This is d minus p minus one form in d space time dimensions. Then the conservation equation can be written like this. The exterior derivative of the Hodge star of the current is zero. So this is a conservation equation. And this is just the, in components, this equation is just given like this. So this, I think this equation looks very familiar, at least in the case t equals zero. So this is a very straightforward generalization of the conservation of current in ordinary symmetry. So I will always discuss this kind of p-form symmetry. Then let me define the charge associated to this p-form symmetry. So let's suppose that the space-time is, so I call the space-time, total space-time as x. And let's suppose that the space-time is given by this form. Here, this r is the time direction, and this y is d minus one dimensional space. So let's consider such a space time. And also, let's suppose that there exists a non-trivial cycle, sigma. This is a non-trivial, topologically non-trivial d minus p minus one dimensional cycle. So this dimension is taken so that we can integrate the Hodge star of the current. And also, let's take a time coordinate t. So this t parameterizes this time direction. Then by using this non-trivial cycle and this time coordinate, we can define the charge, which is localized on sigma at the time t by this integral. So this is an integral of the current over this cycle sigma at the time t. So this is a global charge at the time t. Okay, so in this way, if we have a p-form symmetry, more precisely p-form U1 symmetry, then we can define its conserved charge in this way. And we can show the charge conservation by Stokes' theorem. So for this purpose, let's take this cycle gamma. So I take this gamma to be just this cycle sigma times this time direction. Then this boundary is given by this sigma at the time plus infinity minus this sigma at the time minus infinity. So it has boundaries at the time plus and minus infinities. Then the difference of the charges at the time plus infinity and minus infinity can be written as an integral over this boundary of gamma. And then by using Stokes' theorem, we can rewrite this integral in this way. And then this is zero because of the conservation equation of this current. So in this way, in quantum field theory, we can show the charge conservation from the from this local current conservation. So this is the standard proof in quantum field theory. But in quantum gravity, we made some of non-trivial geometries or non-trivial topologies. So I denote these topologies as x, x prime, x double prime, and so on. And here this x is the most basic manifold, so which is this one. But these x prime and x double prime and so on, they can have more complicated topologies. And in this talk, I require that these manifolds have the same asymptotic infinities. So I require that they have the same initial condition and the same final condition. And also, if there are some spatial infinities, then I require that these spatial infinities are also the same. Then this is conceptually very similar to sum over instantons in gauge theories. So in gauge theories, so we first consider topologically trivial gauge field configuration, and then consider some topologically non-trivial configurations which are localized in the bulk of space-time and so on. And I'm just doing a very similar thing here. So I fix the asymptotic infinity and then sum over non-trivial topologies inside the bulk of space-time. So the situation is something like this. So here, this x is just a cylinder like this. So there's a definite time direction and space direction. But this x prime can have more complicated topologies inside the bulk. And so in this x prime, there's no definite time direction inside the bulk. So it has a very complicated topology. Then I cannot explain the details of this point, but it turns out that for some x prime, for some complicated x prime, it turns out that there exists no cycle gamma which satisfies this property. So there so on this x prime, there exists no gamma whose boundary is given by this sigma at plus infinity and sigma at minus infinity. And this is due to complicated topology of x prime. And this, if this is the case, then the proof of charge conservation by using this Stokes theorem fails on such a manifold. So this proof by Stokes theorem requires the existence of this gamma whose boundary is given by this. But if there is no such gamma, then we cannot use this argument. So by this reason, in quantum gravity, actually there is no proof of charge conservation. So the proof of charge conservation by Stokes theorem fails in quantum gravity. And so therefore, there is no reason that the charge should be conserved. So this is a very general reason that global charge may not be conserved in quantum gravity. And we can show charge violation very explicitly in certain cases, and I will discuss that later in this talk. Yes, and so I will later discuss some gravitational configurations, and it turns out that the configurations I will discuss are the examples of such x prime in which the Stokes theorem fails. But I cannot explain the details of this point because it's technically a bit complicated. So if you are interested, please see my paper for the details of how the Stokes theorem fails. So in this talk, I will more explicitly demonstrate the violation of global symmetry. Okay, next, let me review the concept of surgery. So I will claim that some geometric configurations, some gravitational configurations in Euclidean path integrals have a physical interpretation as virtual black brains. And I argue that these virtual black brains are realized by a mathematical construction, which is known as surgery. And I believe that we also need some generalization. So I will review the concept of this surgery and its physical motivation. So, but before going to discuss this surgery in a general situation, let me first give an example to motivate this surgery construction. So as an example, let me discuss a virtual black hole. So let's start from this manifold, which does not contain any black hole. So this is just a flat space-time. And in this talk, I will only discuss about the topologies. And for topological discussions, it will be convenient to consider this, this just flat space topologically as a disk. And the boundary of the disk is the infinity of this asymptotic infinity of this Euclidean space. So I regard this X just as a like this. So disk times S1. So let's consider such a space time. Now let's consider a black hole. So in Lorentz signature, black hole can be described by this kind of metric. And here, the details are not important at all. But so there's some horizon, R star. And then we go to the Euclidean signature metric by big rotation. So we plotted the time direction, and then we require that the geometry after the weak rotation is smooth at the horizon. Then it is well known that after this requirement, this time coordinate becomes a periodic variable. So I denote this periodic variable as theta. So it must have a periodicity to pi to make the geometry smooth. So then the square root of r minus r star, the distance from the horizon, and this parameter theta, so they give a polar coordinates of a space, which is topologically two-dimensional disk. And the boundary of this disk is the asymptotic infinity. So if we consider a black hole in Euclidean signature, the topology is like this. The topology, including the black hole, is d minus two-dimensional sphere times two-dimensional disk. So I denote this geometry as x prime. So we have these two manifolds, x and x prime. And we can interpret them in the following way. So we have started from this geometry x, which was d minus one-dimensional disk times one-dimensional sphere. And then we put a virtual black hole at the center of the disk. So we consider this disk, and then we put a black hole at the center of the disk. And this black hole is going around the S1 direction. Then such a configuration can be realized by a smooth geometry. So virtual black hole at the center of the disk becomes a smooth geometry, which is topologically different from the original geometry. So we can interpret these two manifolds in this way. And in Euclidean signature, it is not important which is the time direction and which is space direction. So in this discussion, I have regarded this S1 as the time direction, but we don't need to require that this S1 as the time direction, because in Euclidean signature, there is no distinction between space and time. So we can regard this S1 as a space direction. And in that case, this black hole is a virtual black hole, which is localized in the time direction. And an important point in this construction is that these two manifolds have the same boundaries. So they both have the boundaries given by this d minus two-dimensional sphere times S1. So this means that this x and x prime have the same asymptotic infinity, and so they can contribute to the same path integral. And here I discussed the case of, I started from the flat space-time, but if we consider a virtual black hole in ADS, then the fact that both x and x prime contribute to the same path integral is very important for reproducing the thermodynamic properties of CFT. So this was discussed by Witten. So this x corresponds to the confining phase of the CFT, and this x prime corresponds to the deconfinement phase of CFT. So to reproduce the confinement and deconfinement of the gauge theory, we needed to include both of these geometries in the gravitational path integral. Okay, now I can describe this surgery more generally. Mathematically, surgery is a procedure to obtain a new manifold x prime from a given manifold x in the following way. So this x is just a very general manifold. And let's consider such a general manifold. And let's assume that this X contains a subspace, which is topologically a disk times a sphere. Then we replace this subspace. So this D minus P dimensional disk times P dimensional sphere by sphere times disk. So this is a P minus P minus one dimensional sphere times P plus one dimensional disk. Then after this replacement, we get a new manifold. And I denote this new manifold as X prime. So in this way, we can obtain a new manifold, and this is a surgery in mathematics. And this construction is possible because this space and this space have the same boundary, which is just a sphere times a sphere. So this is a surgery. Now, let me give another example to demonstrate the importance of this surgery. So another example is ADS CFT of P minus one brain. So if we consider some brains such as D3 brain or M2 brain or M5 brain, then we can consider the gravity dual of these brains. And we may interpret the Euclidean version of ADS-CFT related to this P minus one brain in the following way. So let's wrap these brains on SP, P dimensional sphere. So this SP is the Euclidean spacetime for the CFT. Then its gravitational dual is the Euclidean version of ADS P plus one. And the Euclidean version of ADS is a hyperbolic space. And hyperbolic space is topologically just a disk, P plus one dimensional disk. Then we can consider the following duality. P minus one plane, which is wrapped on SP and which is localized at the center of the disk, is dual to the geometry, smooth geometry, which is a sphere times a disk. So wrapping a virtual P plane may have the same effect as surgery, at least in this simple case. So this is one evidence that virtual P minus one brains can be realized by surgery of Euclidean spacetime. So they are actually dual to each other, at least in string theory. Okay, so now let me discuss the shift symmetry of axions. So axions can be realized by some compactification of higher dimensional theories. So in particular, in string theory, we can obtain string axions in this way by compactifying string theory on some higher dimensional manifolds. But this mechanism is very general, and we don't need to assume string theory. And I discuss an explicit mechanism of the shift symmetry violation in quantum gravity, which is very generic and which is not restricted to string theories. So the construction which I will discuss is motivated by string theory, but it does not require string theory at all. So it can happen in any theory of quantum gravity. So let me discuss this violation of shift symmetry. So as a higher dimensional theory, I consider a p-form gauge field. So this A is a p-form gauge field. This is just the standard p-form. And the field strength is denoted by this F. And I assume that this F has just the standard action given by this. So this is a very simple action for the p-form gauge field. This is just a free theory. And the equation of motion is just given by this. The exterior derivative of the Hodge star of F is zero. And this theory has a p-form global U1 symmetry. So we can shift this p-form field A by some closed form. So here this eta is some closed p-form. So this is a generalization of the usual shift symmetry to higher form symmetry. So the free action of this p-form gauge field has this kind of p-form U1 symmetry. And the net current turns out to be given by this. The net current is given by this Hodge star of F up to some constant. And I define this Hodge star of F as F tilde. So this F tilde is the electromagnetic dual of this of the original field strength. And this electromagnetic duality can be shown by using the using this action. And I will later use this action for the purpose of some computation of the low energy effective action. So this action is given in terms of F tilde and A. So we regard F tilde and A as fundamental variables. And if we integrate out F tilde, then we get the original action of A. So this action is equivalent to the original theory. But if we integrate out A, then we get the dual action. So in that way, we can show the electromagnetic duality. But for the purpose of today's talk, I just need this term for my later discussion. So I will come back to this action later. Okay, now let's compactify the space-time on some internal manifold N. So I take the space-time as RD times this internal manifold N. So the total dimension is capital D, and this internal manifold has a dimension capital D minus small d. And our purpose is to study the low energy theory on RD after this compactification. And also, let's suppose that there exists some cycle C. So this is a cycle with dimension P. So if there exists such a cycle, which is topologically non-trivial, then we get a scalar field in the low energy theory. And I call this scalar field an action. So this scalar field is defined by integrating this p-form field over this cycle. So this is a scalar field on low energy RD, and it has a shift symmetry. So the shift symmetry of this action comes from the higher dimensional p-form symmetry, which shifts the p-form gauge field in this way. So the shift symmetry is described by like this. The shift parameter is given by the integral of this eta. So in quantum field theory, because of the p-form symmetry in higher dimensions, this shift symmetry in lower dimension is exact in quantum field theory. But this will be violated in quantum gravity. So if we only consider this x, rd times n, then the shift symmetry is exactly preserved, and the action is exactly massless. However, in quantum gravity, we may sum over geometries, x plus x prime and plus x double prime and so on. And these manifolds can break the shift symmetry. So let me discuss this point. So as a setup, I consider this kind of setup. So I define this cycle Cx. So this Cx is defined as a cycle C inside of this manifold times just a point on Rd. So the situation is like this. So we have this lower dimensional Rd, and then we take a point X on Rd. Then over this point, we have an internal manifold N. And in this N, we have a non-trivial cycle. And I denote this non-trivial cycle as Cx. And this Cx is projected to a single point on Rd. And this is important. So this Cx, this entire cycle Cx is just projected to a single point in the lower dimensional space. And if we have grains in the theory, some fundamental grains in the theory, like in string theory, then we can consider grain instantons. The grain instantons, which are wrapped on this Cx, would give a contribution which breaks the shift symmetry of the action. And this mechanism is very well known in string theory. So we wrap a brain here, and that is called brain instantons. And then this brain instantons produce a effective action like this. And this effective action breaks the shift symmetry of this pi. So in this way, in string theory, the action gets massed down. The shift symmetry is violated. So this is very, very known. But my purpose is to reproduce the same effect purely geometrically. And my construction is inspired by the correspondence between this virtual black brain and surgery. So as I mentioned before, we can consider this correspondence as a gravity dual of brain instantons. And this surgery do not assume string theory at all. So this construction can be applied to any theory of quantum gravity. So this is a very general mechanism. Okay, for simplicity, let me assume two things. So I assume that this cycle C is topologically a sphere, p-dimensional sphere. And I also assume that this p is greater than zero. So this sphere is connected. And also, I assume that the normal bundle to this Cx inside of this X is topologically trivial. So let me assume these things for technical simplicity. Then under these assumptions, we can take a tubular neighborhood of this Cx. So this means that the neighborhood of this Cx is given by some disk times a sphere. And this Cx is located at the center of the disk. And this Cx itself is wrapped on this SP. So the neighborhood of this Cx is described by this subspace inside the X. Then we can perform the surgery. So we replace this subspace by this space. So after this replacement, we obtain a new manifold, which I denote by X prime. So this was the surgery which I revealed before. And after this surgery, we get a new non-trivial cycle, which is a sphere of dimension d minus p minus 1. So this is a sphere which appears here. So we get a new non-trivial cycle, and then we can put the flux of the gauge field. And so I introduce a flux such that the integral of this F tilde over this non-trivial cycle is given by some integer Q. So I introduce such a flux. And this flux is dual of the Brayton charge. If we consider Brayton in string theory. But I emphasize that this configuration is just a very smooth geometry. I just introduced a smooth flux, and I don't need to assume string theory at all. Okay, so then we need to know the contribution to the path integral from this new geometry X prime. And for this computation, I want to use this action, which I presented before. And in particular, this second term is very important. This second term gives a symmetry breaking term from a surface term integration by parts. I don't discuss the details, but this is somewhat similar to the topological theta term and instanton contributions in gauge theories. So in gauge theories, the topological theta term is just a total derivative. So we can rewrite this theta term as a surface term at infinity. But in the presence of the instanton, the surface term gives a non-trivial contribution, and then that contribution breaks the shift symmetry of the theta parameter. And somewhat analogously, this term gives a term which breaks the shift symmetry of the action. So let me present the result. So let's recall that I have introduced this flux of F tilde. And also, let's recall that the action field is defined by the integral of this A over C. Then, after some computation, it turns out that this integral is given by this quantity, Q times phi axion. So this Q comes from this F tilde, this flux, and this phi axion comes from this from the surface term of this dA. So this, so I get this contribution in the action. So the contribution from x prime to the path integral is given by this. So this left hand side is path integral of the metric field and the p-form gauge field. And so this gives a contribution like this. So this is a integral of this exponential 2 pi I q phi over the point x. And this integral over the point x comes from the integration over the position where we perform surgery. And this is analogous to the position of position modulus of the instanton in gauge theories. So we finally conclude that the contribution of x prime to the low energy effective action on RD is given by this formula. So this contribution, which is obtained by surgery, is given by the integral of some operator over x, and this operator is the exponential of the action field. So this is the standard shift simply breaking term of an action field. And so in this way, just by considering a smooth geometry, we can produce a local operator which breaks the shift symmetry of the action. So, and also this is just a local operator. So this is conceptually much clearer than this kind of non-local terms which are produced by Euclidean wormholes. Okay, so I'm kind of running out of time, but finally, let me discuss one example. So I have to go very quickly. So let's consider this example. So let's take this x as R3 times S1. So the internal manifold is S1. And also, let's take this cycle to the S1. And let's consider just a one-form gauge field. So one-form gauge field means usual Maxwell field in four dimensions. Then after the surgery, this X prime turns out to be given by the Euclidean version of Reisner-Nordstrom black hole with charge Q. So we know many properties of this Reisner-Nordstrom black hole. And in particular, we can compute the gravitational action of this black hole configuration. So gravitational action is given by this formula, which is given by Gibbons-Hawking. And in this formula, this S is the entropy of the black hole. So this is the entropy of the black hole. And this E is the energy of the black hole, or in other words, this is the mass of the virtual black hole. And this beta is the inverse temperature, which is the length of S1. And this phi is the chemical potential. So these are the interpretations of these quantities if we regard this S1 as a Euclidean time direction. Then we can estimate contribution of this Reisner-Nordstrom black hole like this. And this has a very simple interpretation. So first of all, these terms minus beta m plus 2 pi I q pi has a very simple interpretation as an action of a particle. So this is exactly the action of a particle with mass n and the charge q. So this action suggests that we can really interpret the black hole as a charged particle. And also, this exponential of S can be interpreted as the number of states of the black hole which are contributing to the passing here. So I stress that I just evaluated the gravitational action of a smooth geometry, just a smooth Euclidean geometry, but that action has a very simple interpretation in terms of a particle of mass m and charge q, and the number of states is given by exponential of S. So this action gives the size of the symmetry violation. Okay, so let me conclude. So global symmetries can be violated by topologically non-trivial configurations in quantum gravity. And the main message is that the local current conservation does not imply global charge conservation because of the complicated topologies. And in the case of symmetries, which are obtained by compactification of higher home symmetries, so this violation by a virtual black brain or surgery is local in the low energy effective theory. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much for a very nice talk. Okay, if you have questions or comments to make, please. Yeah, there is one. Pablo?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
Very nice talk. I was wondering your comment that, well, maybe I had two questions. Maybe first, your comment that you made that you don't know if there will be double counting, or you don't know if you can identify always your constructions with the D-brains in string theory.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it seems quite obvious, quite clear that they should be the same, like from your example of these axions from Reisner-Nostrum black holes. Mm-hmm. And the constructions of D-brains, the identifications of D-brains and black brains in string theory, wouldn't you expect them to be just the same thing?
Okay, so yeah, I expect them to be just the same, but I mean, so where was that point? I couldn't find the slide, but I expect that this my smooth geometry and this brain instant in string theory are completely the same. So if we include bones of them, I believe that is overcounting. Mm-hmm. But I don't know the general rule of which configuration to sum and which configuration not to sum.
Well, I think my second question is about whether you can say anything about what are solutions or not. Because if you can't, then probably your construction is topological and it doesn't tell you that.
Whether
there are solutions or what are the solutions, what are the field configurations, what are the actions, except in this case where you have the Reisner-Nostrum black hole.
Mm-hmm.
So that was my second question. Generic construction cannot say anything about that, right?
Yeah, I didn't prove that they are solutions of gravitational equations. So I don't know they are subtle or not. But in the case of JT gravity, there are some configurations which are not the saddle point, but still they are contributing to the path integral. So I think we also have to consider off-shell configurations very seriously in quantum gravity.
Yeah, I'm always puzzled by that particular property of JT gravity, but and how it could generalize to higher dimensions. But.
Yeah, I don't know how to generalize it to higher dimensions. Yeah, that's a very difficult question. Yeah.
All right. Thank you. That's all.
Thank you.